What do you get when you mix James Bond, Man from U.N.C.L.E., Tomb Raider, Indiana Jones, Mission Impossible, Uncharted, and Charlie's Angels? You get a comic book called Danger Girl. Let's talk about it. But before we do, let me say thank you for watching JLS Comics. If you like the video, hit the thumbs up and subscribe because I do upload videos just like this each and every week. Okay, let's get back to our story. Created by J. Scott Campbell and Andy Hartnell, Danger Girl hit comic book stores in the spring of 1998. Campbell had just come off another smash success in his Gen 13 title in order to work on this new project. The miniseries was preceded by a preview zero-issue comic book with a cover date of December 97, which introduced the main cast and highlighted artwork and concept sketches from Campbell himself. Then there was a cliffhanger issue zero comic book that came with Wizard Magazine issue 80 in early 1998, which featured a preview of Campbell's Danger Girl, Humberto Ramos's book Crimson, and Joe Madureira's Battle Chasers, all three set to be released via Image imprint Cliffhanger. The Danger Girl series, tapping into the trends of the time, was an immediate hit. They also wanted to create a book full of action, amazing set pieces, and full of battles and explosion and dynamic action, tackling car chases, gunfights, and adventures. Basically, a movie on the page. In fact, Campbell started out wanting to be an animator before he got into the comic book world. So who are the Danger Girls? Before Abbey Chase was a Danger Girl, she was an intrepid adventurer and treasure hunter. She's a sniper, a buxom polyglot, and a student of history. It was through this line of work that she encountered the Danger Girl team and was recruited. In the Danger Girl preview comic book, Abby was in Costa Rica hunting for Mayan treasure, the golden skull of Cuco Diego, which an evil, maniacal, eye-patched, toupee-wearing, Timothy Dalton's Bond-esque guy named Donovan Conrad had in his possession. Donovan tried to kill Abby, but an explosion saved her. We also get a speedboat chase and a car chase, which ended with Abby's jeep being forced off a cliff by Donovan's men. A friend of Abby's named Duncan is meant to be two things, a nod to Jack Wade, an American CIA officer like Felix Leiter who'd help out Pierce Brosnan's 1990s James Bond from time to time, but he also looks suspiciously similar to Campbell's friend and editor Scott Dumbier, who after many years confirmed that this was intentional. Duncan was a spy too and had connections to MI6 through an agent named Deuce, and it was Duncan who recommended his friend Abby for the Danger Girl team. It turns out that when Abby went over the cliff, she saw Donovan trying to escape in his speedboat he named the Snuggler. So Abby used a spear gun to get onto his boat, steal the golden skull, and escape with help from the Danger Girl team. Natalia swung down on a rope ladder, and she pulled her up into the helicopter just as Donovan's speedboat went over the waterfall as toupee came off and the speedboat exploded. This is when Abby met her new team, Deuce, Sydney Savage, Silicon Valerie, and Natalia Castle. Deuce, basically the team's Charlie, told Abby that in the early 1960s he was an MI6 agent on Her Majesty's Secret Service. Like James Bond, she asked him? She was onto something as Deuce was modeled after James Bond actor Sean Connery. Is Deuce another way to say 00, as in 007? Is this what Bond does when he retires? When the Soviet Union collapsed in 1991, Deuce's unit was stood down and he went into retirement, a casualty of cutbacks. But he was called out of retirement to deal with a new looming threat, which was the emergence of a Fourth Reich that had laid dormant, yet percolating just beneath the surface of world events, waiting for their time to come forward once again, and with the collapse of the USSR as a global superpower, it was their time once more. Danger Girl's formation was a direct response to this very emerging threat. Deuce recruited his new female agents, Sydney Savage, as her name suggests, from Australia. She employs the Jennifer Lawrence sex as a weapon Red Sparrow techniques to manipulate both her friends and her foes. In fact, she has a thing with Johnny Barracuda, a CIA agent whose sex drive matches her sex appeal. Sydney's the team's surveillance expert, bullwhip lover, and helicopter pilot. It's said that her prowess with a bullwhip is as legendary as her audacious sense of risk. Natalia Castle was a former Russian intelligence operative who loves fighting, combat, and loves her knives. The team also has a young techie Oxford grad named Silicon Valerie, a not-so-subtle play on Silicon Valley, the area famous for its computer and tech cluster of companies, especially during the dot-com bubble of the late 90s. She's the team's technology and comms expert. And their first mission was to chase down a trio of artifacts that a mysterious organization called Hammer wanted to use. They were the ones trying to revive the Nazi Party as a Fourth Reich. At first, the Danger Girl team was reluctant to let such an adventurer as Abby join the team. Someone willing to take unnecessary risks. Someone with a shady past, they said, that they didn't really know. Silicon said Abby's a DiCaprio fan, so she can't be that bad. Deuce believed in her, he said, and as they talked at the stern of his yacht. So Abby, after this conversation, said, yes, I'll join the team. And Abby's first mission with Danger Girl sent her to France to track down the first of the three objects that Hammer wanted. In France, she had to surveil a transactional meeting between a Hungarian art thief named Rico Lugosi and a smuggler named the Peach. Rico had the first artifact, an ancient mystical shield from Atlantis called the Shield of Immunity, and the Peach was there to buy it on behalf of Hammer. This was the diabolical peach. You know, that I could eat a peach for hours, Castor Troy reference. In fact, Face Off had just come out in the summer of 97. It was fresh on everyone's minds. At the bistro, Abby disguised herself as a waitress, but her dress was too small. And as she waited on Peach and Rico's table, Peach slapped her derriere. We'll use the French term since this happened in France. The Peach killed Rico and stole the shield, and so Abby chased him in her Porsche Boxster, but the car chase was halted abruptly as these pair of helicopters came in and started shooting at Abby in her car. Abby's Porsche was like James Bond's Aston Martins, which were full of gadgets and weapons, and she was able to take out both of the helicopters. And a ninja, inspired by G.I. Joe's Snake Eyes, named Agent Zero, disguised as a guy named Jacques, picked up Abby and ended up taking Abby and Sydney to their rendezvous with Natalia. They were able to track the Peach to a mansion in Switzerland owned by Hammer, where Abby met a CIA operative and ally named Johnny Barracuda, who J. Scott Campbell says was modeled after Bruce Campbell. Despite the same last name, I'm sure there's no relation between the two. At the party, Abby found where the Peach was keeping the shield and was about to take it when he walked in, so she quickly jumped into a hot tub full of bubbles and pretended her body was his gift. Abby and Johnny managed to make it out of the mansion, past the Hammer shock troops with the shield in their possession. So they jumped on snowmobiles to make their escape, and they were pursued by more Hammer agents, narrowly escaping an avalanche, but made it to a cabin where they met up with the rest of the Danger Girls, and they began planning the recovery of the second artifact, another Atlantean relic known as the Helmet of Second Sight. A guy named Eddie in England had the helm at his home, but Major Maxim, who's basically a cross between Star Wars' Darth Vader and Hellboy's Cronin, along with some Hammer shock troops, stormed into his home looking for the artifact and knocked him out. Abby and the team headed to England to find Eddie. Along the way, Natalia actually gave Abby a ring as a token of their friendship. Remember that. When they arrived at Eddie's house, he showed them the helmet, and that's when Hammer showed up again and took it, but they also took Sydney and Johnny hostage, and they took them back to an island. The Hammer troops used a tank to push Eddie's house over a cliff, and they shot Natalia too, and everyone thought she was dead. This was happening as Hammer troops attacked Deuce on the Danger Yacht, the Danger Girl team's mobile base of operations. Agent Zero was able to rescue Abby, Silicon, and Eddie from the cliff, and he took them to a ship owned by a guy named Tanaka. They then used a submersible to go down to the floor of the ocean to get the Sword of Sovereignty, the third artifact from a sunken Nazi submarine. Hammer agents attacked them and stole the sword, and this is when they realized that Natalia didn't die when she was shot. She pretended. Not only that, but she was a double agent, and she was working with Hammer all along. That ring Natalia gave to Abby, it was actually a tracking device, so that's how they knew exactly where they were and where the third artifact was. Natalia had taken Sydney and Johnny to the Hammer Führer's Hammer Island. Abby and the team headed to the island as well to rescue Sydney and Johnny. Agent Zero was there too, and he met up with Assassin X, so they were basically like Storm Shadow and Snake Eyes. Hammer Führer brought the three Atlantean artifacts together, and they transformed him into an ancient Atlantean general named Atticlius. In the fight with Atticlius, Abby fired missiles from a helicopter, which destroyed a dam on the island. And the island was destroyed, and the three artifacts were washed out into the ocean, where they disappeared once more. And in the devastation, Natalia fell out of a helicopter as the island exploded, seemingly killing her. And so this was the end of the first miniseries. It was fraught with massive delays, and an entire year went by between issues 6 and 7. Despite the miniseries having 7 issues, the title ramped up the variant cover trend, with each issue having multiple covers, upwards of 6, with chromium treatments, gold foil editions, treasury editions, different artwork, and exclusives with companies like Dynamic Forces, American Entertainment, and Another Universe. In 1998, with not just the launch of this book, but really Cliffhanger as part of Image's Wildstorm imprint, the team went on a signing tour to promote all their books. The popularity of the series proved to be a double-edged sword for Campbell. He needed to keep up with work on the book, but at the same time figure out the action figures, designs for the upcoming video game, and even a film that New Line Cinema wanted to make. More on that in a moment. He was pulled in all of these directions, which exacerbated the delays exponentially. Despite this, popularity and demand remained high, and the story of Abby Chase and of the Danger Girl team would continue on for many more years. In 2001's two-issue Danger Girl Kamikaze, Abby Chase and Sydney are in Hong Kong trying to stop a new group named Kama that were led by a villain named Shogunner, and who were inspired by Hammer and intended to detonate a positronium bomb in America. It turns out that they were using nuclear fusion technology and isotopes developed by the Germans to create an antimatter bomb with the codename Kamikaze. They tracked it through Hong Kong and even the ruins of Angkor Wat in Cambodia by using a World War II era Axis map. At the ruins of a crashed transport plane, they met up with Ma Yao of the Hong Kong Police Special Duties Unit. It was a Japanese submersible that was scuttled in the South China Sea, which had some of the components on it for the bomb. So the Danger Girl team took the Danger Yacht, their second one, to the site, but they were ran by a Russian Oscar III-class submarine bearing Kama flags. They were captured, but they managed to escape and destroyed the platform they were being held on, and Sydney showed up with her new man-eating friend, a crocodile named Puck Puck. The leader and the group were taken down and the bomb destroyed and the map returned to Mai at the end of the story. After this, the Danger Girl team went to Hawaii for some much-needed R&R, but quickly found themselves amidst another caper where they had to stop Don Kanui from hypnotizing a U.S. admiral into launching missiles at the United States. In 2004's Danger Girl, Viva Lost Danger, the team and Johnny Barracuda were in Las Vegas with Prince Aku and needing to recover a precious jewel called the Jewel of Eternity. 2005 saw the release of Danger Girl Odd Jobs, which reprinted Hawaiian Punch and Viva Lost Danger, but also included a new story. Then the team crossed over with Batman for Batman Danger Girl. Deuce sent the Danger Girl team to Gotham City, where they met up with Batman to take down Abby's old foe, Donovan Conrad. Yes, he was back. He survived the crash over the waterfall. Donovan had gone to the Joker to cut a deal, but Joker cut off Donovan's hand at the wrist with a meat cleaver. Bruce Wayne met Abby Chase at a car dealership, and Bruce bought Abby a Mercedes under the condition that she join him at a Gotham Historical Society formal soiree. And she ended up saying yes, she loves history. It was a good fit. Sydney and Selina Kyle, Catwoman, got to crack whips at each other too. In 2006's Danger Girl Back in Black, the Danger Girl team found themselves in an all-girl biker gang named the Black Widows on a mission to recover yet another artifact. This time a Native American one, a mystical skull called Black Seed that was lost during the massacre at Wounded Knee. And this is when they also meet a new friend named Ruby. 2007's Danger Girl Body Shot sent the team to recover a Master Key, a device which could access and launch any nuclear missile in the world. A general working for the United States president detonated nuclear bombs around the globe to force the president to surrender to a guy named Franco. Talk about betrayal. July of 2009 marked the time when Danger Girl went from Wildstorm to IDW Publishing. This led to Abby's next adventure in 2011. IDW Publishing, along with Dynamite Entertainment, announced that Abby would be back, this time as Danger Girl battled the Army of Darkness. The book found Abby teaming up with Ash. She likes to track down artifacts, so this time she was after the Necronomicon, yes, the Book of the Dead. Andy Hartnell commented on the book in an interview. Fans of the original Danger Girl series may recall seeing the infamous Necronomicon in the library of one Abby Chase way back in her days before joining the Danger Girl organization. They've always asked what that was all about. Well, now is the time to revisit that adventure. Now that Abby is a full-fledged Danger Girl with her new skills and allies, she also has the help from some knucklehead named Ash. During Danger Girl Revolver, Abby was trying to track down a Peruvian artifact when Sydney's sister Sonia was recruited to the team. Sonia is a bounty hunter and former Australian secret intelligence agent. A lady named Veronica Fox had Sonia working with Danger Girl for the mission, which led to her joining Danger Girl. Later in 2012, IDW Publishing re-released the Danger Size Treasury Editions from the first series. After this, the team crossed over with G.I. Joe for Danger Girl G.I. Joe in 2012. In this miniseries, Flint and Scarlet were missing, down during a mission where Cobra and their Rattlers attacked a C-17 transport plane loaded with top-secret cargo, which was prototype Nazi weapons they'd recovered while diving on a wreck in the Baltic Sea. Because the cargo was lost, Madam President suspended all G.I. Joe operations. And it turns out that CoverGirl knew Johnny Barracuda, whom she'd met while hitching a ride on a French C-130 years ago. He had mentioned candidly at the time to CoverGirl that he was an agent and he had someone who infiltrated Cobra. Fast forward to the present, and Scarlet and Flint ran into some Cobra elements led by none other than Abby Chase, agent of Cobra. She was naturally paired up with the Baroness. In fact, she looked like a blonde Baroness with a catsuit that borrowed Destro's red collar. So Deuce, Johnny, and the rest of the Danger Girls landed on the USS flag, and when they landed, Sydney attacked the president and peeled her face off, and it turns out that the president wasn't the president, nope, at all. It was Zarana in disguise. It also turns out that Abby was the agent Johnny was talking about when he first met CoverGirl, and she had the Danger Girl team and G.I. Joe team up to stop Destro, Major Blood, Baroness Zartan from exploding the prototype weapons. In 2013's Danger Girl Trinity, the girls were trying to stop a sultan from destroying an Egyptian crown, the only piece of evidence that could challenge his claim to the throne. The false sultan had captured Abby and wanted to force her to treasure hunt for him, or he would kill her. But it all worked out. Later, Abby had a blink and you'll miss it cameo in IDW's Infestation 2 series. She was on the cover of the first issue, but then showed up in issue 2 for just a couple panels. Danger Girl The Chase was another miniseries which came out in 2013. They had to keep a briefcase out of the hands of an assassin named Anastasia Kilborn. Anastasia had actually trained with Natalia many years ago, had similar fighting styles. By now, Silicon Valerie was going by Valerie Evans. It turns out that the briefcase was a containment box for a powerful antimatter device which could control weather, gravity, and making people's skeletons appear, but its specifics were kept secret through all four issues, and we'll never know truly what was in the case, just like we'll never know what was in the case Robert De Niro went after in their movie Ronin. 2014's Danger Girl Mayday was written by Andy Hartnell and John Royal, and here, Natalia came back from the dead. In 2015, a four-issue miniseries called Danger Girl Renegade came out, and it featured variants from Buy Me Toys, Jamie Tyndall via Yesteryear, a convention exclusive, and Campbell's own subscription variant. It was continuing with that trend of many covers. The next year, a Permission to Thrill adult coloring book was released, and in 2018, J. Scott Campbell and IDW Publishing wanted to celebrate 20 years of Danger Girl, so a prestige Danger Girl 20 Years was released, which included pencils and line art from Danger Girl's first couple of issues, plus inked and colored versions. In the year 2000, THQ Incorporated put out a Danger Girl video game for PlayStation, which was supposed to take place in between the first and second story arcs. The game introduced another female agent to the team, a lady named JC. And since inception, in 1998, Hollywood has tried to bring Danger Girl to film, seeing the immense potential for the property. From New Line Cinema to Paramount's UPN TV network to Constantine Films, and even with once a false rumor about Kate Beckinsale, Mia Jovovich, and Sofia Vergara being attached. It's long been in development, and it's been described as Buffy the Vampire Slayer meets Raiders of the Lost Ark. The latest news comes in 2019 with Jeff Wadlow on board and Campbell and Hartnell themselves on board as EPs, executive producers. But whether they keep the original flavor or tone it down amidst the current socio-political climate remains to be seen. Either way, I'll definitely watch it. Until then, that's a wrap on this one, my friends. Thank you for watching, and don't forget to subscribe so you can be one of the first to know when I upload videos just like this each and every week. I'm Jesse, this is JLS Comics, and I'll see you soon.